Good morning, everybody. Welcome to The Resilient Show on a glorious almost winter's day in New Zealand. This is The Resilient Show on Arrow FM. If you're in the Wairarapa, that's 92.7 FM. If you are anywhere else on planet Earth, have a look at www.arrowfm.co.nz or even just Google The Resilient Show. You don't even have to go all the way to the website. We're getting that much following now. You can just find it on Mr. Google. So The Resilient Show today is, the title of the show is The Colour Pink. I was going to entitle it Everything Pink, but then I thought, maybe that sounds a little bit dodgy. It is The Colour Pink, and for those of you who are watching on Wairarapa TV, I went into the cupboard this morning to get a pink shirt. I have always owned a pink shirt, and I don't have one. I don't own a pink shirt anymore. So I turned around and grabbed one of Liz's pink scarves instead. So if you're watching Wairarapa TV, that's why I've got a pink scarf round my neck. And what is the point of the colour pink? Well, across New Zealand, today is Pink Shirt Day, a day that we wear pink to stand up to the bullies. So today's show is dedicated to everyone who stands up to the bully. And we're going to talk more about what that might actually mean in the next segment. But the show today, really, really excited. We have got Julia is coming on as our first guest to talk about her book, her story, which quite nicely, and I'd love to say I planned this, quite nicely dovetails into the whole concept of Pink Shirt Day. We've then got the book review, very cool book for today, a good fun book to review today. And after that, we are talking to Glenn, a sculptor from the Hawke's Bay. I am loving watching his designs, his imagination on Facebook, and some of the artwork that he has created, absolutely amazing. So that's today's show. We're going to get started, though, because it's Friday and it's time for a boogie. But I've started a little bit slower this week for you. You can get up, you can move around. Remember, get up, move around, have some fun, get some dancing.
But a slow glowing dream that your fear seems to hide deep inside your mind.
What a feeling. Irene Cara from the film Flashdance. How cool is that? So let's talk a little bit about bullying. But that's not actually where I want to start the conversation. I want to just think about for a minute. This morning, I got up at very, very early o'clock this morning, and in order to get into the studio, get things set up for 7:30, and I stepped out onto our deck, and the dog shot past me to go and, I don't know, chase some birds and, you know, do what dogs do in the garden in the morning. I digress. I was looking out at the sky, and we are so fortunate where we live. We can look across the heavens and throughout the year watch the Milky Way tracking almost like the hands of a clock across the sky. And at this time of year, early in the morning, we see the constellation Scorpio in the middle of the Milky Way. Wasn't there this morning. Now, obviously, my first thought was the world is going to end. The sky is falling. Where has Scorpio gone? Where has the constellation of Scorpio gone? Because obviously, that's bound to be the thing that happened on a Friday morning when I step out onto the deck. I was the first person to find out the world was ending. No, turns out Scorpio was there. I was looking in the wrong place. I was looking too low across the horizon. I didn't lift my head up, to look into the heavens. I was looking almost down the way, across the way at best. And how's that for an analogy of life? We have the opportunity to achieve anything we want in our short time in these earthly suits, in our short time on planet Earth. We can do anything we want. And as children, and I've spoken about this before, as children we play and we imagine. And as we grow up, as our brains develop, we begin to question ourselves. We begin to question our abilities to do many things. And if we took time to look up and realise, wow, I can do whatever I want, what a different world it would be. Now, what's that got to do with bullying? Well, you know, sometimes the worst bully that we have to deal with is ourselves. We talk ourselves down all of the time. We worry about what people will think, so we tell ourselves that we're not good enough. And that's the way that we go through life. So today, wearing a pink shirt, or a pink scarf, if you didn't have a shirt, I will sort that out later on today. A pink scarf or a pink shirt, whatever pink you are wearing today, don't bully yourself. Talk yourself up. Don't look across at the horizon. Lift your eyes to the heavens and see what you could get involved in. But then the other side of bullying is when other people do it to us. And I'm quite sure that most of us, if we think back throughout our lives, there has been some point in our lives where we've probably been bullied. I spent my school years being bullied, being the odd one out, being picked on, and, you know, an awful lot of it was physical abuse, and that's bad enough. But then it gets to the psychological abuse where you're just excluded. You're left out because people don't understand you. Therefore, they decide to turn against you. And that takes an awful lot of braverism to stand up to, or to be able to figure out how to step through it. How do you deal with being the different one? How do you actually deal with that when actually nobody wants to talk to you? Well, there are a number of ways to do it, and we'll cover some of those at towards the end of the show. But really, if we think about that whole process of standing up and being different, and therefore people taking a dislike to you because you are different to them, and therefore they turn against you, and whether it's physical or psychological bullying that comes along, actually, it's their ego that is telling them that they are the fearful ones. They are the ones that cannot understand. Therefore, they need to make themselves feel good. And unfortunately, as we develop, but actually some of us never develop beyond wee boys and girls, we get stuck. And in order to protect ourselves, we put other people down. And that is the start point of bullying. Catch yourself. And I'm not saying for a minute that everyone out there is a bully, but when you use your judgment or are judgmental, and that's what we're going to cover later on in the show, when you're being judgmental and you call something out just because, well, you know, that's the start point of bullying. That's where you're beginning to say, my way is right, everyone else is wrong. And then we begin to close up. We put barriers up. It would make so much sense to play Undivided, the Tim McGraw song that we played last week. I'm not going to play it again. We do have a Tim McGraw song coming up later on in the show, as promised to Ocean last week. But that's what causes division. Division is caused by people saying, I'm right, you're wrong. This is black, this is white. Well, rather than division, let's bring it together. Let's recognise the strength in everyone. Let's not make it black or white. Let's, seeing as today is Pink Shirt Day or Pink Scarf Day, let's actually come together. Because if we come together, we are far more likely to dance rather than actually start fighting. So really, my message about bullying, I really do hope that rather than battling, I hope you dance. Dan Womack, I hope you dance. Get out there and dance. You're going, go and shake someone's hand. Go and find out what your differences are and actually work on the differences, because you actually find out that we're all the same. We don't really have many, many differences other than the ones that we decide to put in there just to make ourselves feel better. So first interview, Julia Strelow, the author of Her Story, is joining us too. And we're just going to have a conversation about, you know, Why do you start writing books? Yeah, I know that. I'm partway through editing mine. But for the moment, let's actually dive in. Julia, good morning.
Good morning, Stu. How are you?
I'm very, very well. Thank you for asking. I just want to dive straight in to your book, Her Story, because I think it dovetails nicely, as I said at the top of the show, to Pink Shirt Day. Am I right?
Yeah, so the Pink Shirt Day is kind of about anti-bullying in the workplace. Is that correct?
That's right. Yep.
Yeah. So Her Story does fit into that category a little bit. It is about resilience. It's a book about women telling their stories and being heard. I guess just for your listeners, so they have an idea about what Her Story is about. Mm-hmm. I reached out to women of New Zealand, mostly New Zealand and the world, and I asked them to share their stories with me. I asked for stories of heartbreak, stories of survival, mm-hmm. and stories of healing. And then I turned those stories into poetry and tried to focus on positive and make them a bit more beautiful, because some of them were really horrible. Mm-hmm. And that book is called Her Story.
Fantastic. How did you manage to turn those stories from words into poetry? Is that your genius?
Well, it was actually quite hard for some of them. I had to really feel, because poetry is very emotional, mm-hmm. and often very personal. So to write other people's stories and turn them into poetry, I had to imagine what those women would have felt, mm-hmm. Which was quite difficult. And then I sent them all back their poems. And that was also, as a writer, very difficult, because you worry, you know, are they going to like it?
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Have I got it right? But luckily they were all very happy. Well, they told me they were anyway. So
That's absolutely beautiful. I remember someone, when I redid the website, someone wrote a poem for me, just a short poem. And that feeling of someone taking the time to understand me sufficiently that they could put some words into prose. Absolutely amazing. So tell me what some of the feedback you got.
Oh, the feedback was what made it worth the while. People would message me saying that they were crying, mm-hmm. that they felt understood and that they felt healed. And that was one of the reasons for doing this book, is every day I would get women who would message me just about my own poetry that I'd written, about my personal experiences, and they'd say that they related or that my poems were getting them through their breakup. One woman was fighting in Afghanistan, and she messaged me to say that my book was helping her get through the war.
Oh, wow.
a lady in Italy, when they were in the really bad lockdown, she said that my book was helping her through the lockdown. So that got me thinking, well, is there something more I could do? Mm-hmm. And I read Man's Search for Meaning, which is a book by Viktor Frankl. He's a psychiatrist, mm-hmm. and a concentration camp survivor. So he coined the term logotherapy. That is the idea that people can find meaning in their suffering,
mm-hmm. totally.
And they can find healing. So that was where the idea for Her Story came from. And that's what I wanted to do. And I feel like I have done that for the women.
Man's Search for Meaning is such an amazing book about such a dark period in human history. Begin to make those books accessible, people who've never considered that sort of book, we've got to find a way to simplify those things. And poetry is a great way to introduce some of those really, really difficult subjects, because I find that you think about poetry, you think about what the writer means. I mean, I do a lot of reading and spend my time actually reflecting on the author. How did you get into poetry? What was the trigger?
Yeah, and you're so right, Stu. That's actually what I'm trying to do with the poetry, is make it accessible to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I think the writing was just in my blood. I grew up on a commune outside of Nimbin in Australia, and we didn't have electricity, so we didn't have television. We had candles at night time, so it was very, very primitive. Mm-hmm. And one of the only things I could do to entertain myself was to read and to write stories. And my mum's also a poet, and I'm never going to be like my mum. That's what I always told myself, but unfortunately it just came out of me somehow, or fortunately.
Well, you know, yeah. I think exactly that. It's fortunate, is being able to, it's having the braverism to step out and say, I'm going to put myself out there and I'm going to take these stories and see if I can help people out, which is, absolutely, it's what a great thing to do. What an amazing service. I'm now really, really interested. Growing up where you did, tell us a little bit more about that lifestyle in Australia.
Well, have you heard of Nimbin?
I have not. No, that's why I'm interested. I'm quite sure everyone else is too.
Yeah, so it's a town, a very small village in northern New South Wales that's famous for marijuana, really.
Okay.
So the whole town's dedicated to that, and there's a lot of hippies there. And they had the Aquarius Festival years ago, and the hippies came there, and then they populated all these communes where people live very primitively, and yeah, that's where I grew up. I haven't been back since I left at 17, though.
Okay, right. And what caused you to leave?
I never really liked it. The house we had was more like a shack, and there was always wildlife getting in. A snake fell on me one night from the roof. There was these anticlines, which are like mice running mm-hmm. around everywhere. So, yeah.
it's really quite interesting. One of the reasons that we landed in New Zealand is because my wife decided that she didn't want things like snakes landing on her in the middle of the night. So we didn't. We just discounted the whole idea of Australia, where basically everything's out to kill you.
It's so lovely in New Zealand to just be able to plow into a big field of grass and not have to worry about it.
Yeah, completely. Although, that we are finding now that the rain's coming, we're now beginning to find a whole more bunch of mice kicking around the place and wondering what's going on. Anyway, sorry, back to the book. We digress. And I love digressing because it's far more of a conversation than a proper interview. How did you find the ladies, the women and their stories to interview, to get the stories in order to create the poetry?
Yeah, I mean, so I call myself an Instagram poet. And the reason why I do that is because my poetry is very different from traditional poets. And I did grow up on traditional poetry, and my poetry is shorter, and to literary critics might be judgmental on Instagram poets. But the whole idea about the Instagram poetry is it is accessible to everyone. So you don't have to be a literary genius to relate to it. And it's short. And I can get my message across to lots of people. So I've got 30,000 followers on Instagram, and I just reached out to them and I asked them to submit to me via my Instagram.
Oh, wow. And did those stories come back across the globe? From across the globe?
Yeah, there was definitely some from across the globe. They're predominantly New Zealand, because that's where I'm based. And sadly, most of the ones about domestic violence, those kind of things, were from New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there were stories from all over the globe.
I feel like I want to dive into a conversation about domestic violence in New Zealand, but I'll probably leave that one for a minute and come back to you must have, and you mentioned it, you must have heard stories of the pain, but also the resilience. So what does resilience mean after the experience of writing the book? What does resilience mean to you?
Yeah, so resilience is a very important to me, and it's a word that does mean something to me, because in my life I've had to be very, very resilient. And so I think what resilience is it's the ability to attack or go for something, and then when life happens or something doesn't work out, to adjust and attack again. That's how I define resilience. And I think that I live in Christchurch. Christchurch is a town full of very resilient people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I feel at home there. And I'm very resilient. The women from this book were resilient. Yeah, I'm digressing. I'm rambling, but
no, it's entirely cool. Yeah, you know, I don't mind a little bit of rambling because that's where we get to the meat of the conversation. I think I'll just pick up on. I think it's really interesting. I did a post earlier on this week about taking the BS out of how to be resilient. But you know, you use the word attack things, and you know, I completely agree that when we are going for something, when we're going after something, it is, you're almost in attack mode. You are so driven. My alarm that goes off during my working day, just to remind me, comes up with the tagline, what more can I do in order to increase my odds for success? Just to remind me to stay driven, even when it's, you know, it's 16 minutes past two in the afternoon, that time when nobody actually does anything because we're all tired after lunch. In order to keep that drive going. What about the other side of resilience? That piece of just going inside and realizing that we've got the strength, does that play a part in your life?
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, resilience has been important to me because of some of the things that I've been through. So, I mean, I've experienced a couple of instances of domestic violence, which is why that's a cause that's passionate to me.
Mm-hmm.
And when something like that happens to you, you want to escape sometimes, and you might want to turn to alcohol or just give up, and so you do have to call upon something inside of you to get past it and not let the pain define you.
Yeah, I think it's and I'm not going to ask you to share personal stories, but I think when we go through bullying or domestic violence, whether that's physical or psychological, having that strength to go inside and then come out and say, as you've just said, this is not going to define me. I am more than that. And I think one place that I think New Zealand is beginning to get there is Pink Shirt Day. It's I think today is also Gumboot Day. Mike King's.
Oh, is it?
I think it is. Yeah, yeah.
I was said, can I wear gumboots to work today? To Sam, my partner, and he was like, "No, you can't." But now maybe I can if it's Gumboot Day.
I would. I saw a photograph of Sam in a field on a tractor. I think you can wear gumboots today. I think you've got the right, as long as you wear a pink shirt as well. But I think we're beginning to waken up to it. Why do you think? All of a sudden, maybe not all of a sudden, but why do you think there is this growing movement in New Zealand to actually face up to the challenge of domestic violence and bullying more particularly?
Bullying. I mean, both. I've actually seen both domestic violence and bullying. I've seen it a lot more in the media lately, which is great to see. I think there's just been a shift, a bit of a conscious shift since COVID. I mean, I know that people started to become more aware of domestic violence around COVID when the news was showing the statistics of domestic violence escalating, and everyone just felt really bad for the idea of these women who might have been trapped in lockdown with their partners.
Mm-hmm.
And then from a bullying perspective, I think the world's just changing, and things that used to be pushed under the carpet are now coming out. And Me Too, you know, has came out, and that now everything, there's, you know, new rules about the way that people conduct themselves in the workplace from a sexual way.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, so bullying needs to be stamped out as well.
And with 30,000 followers on Instagram, great, by the way, absolutely amazing. With 30,000 followers on Instagram, do you think social media has had a part in bringing that consciousness?
Yeah, I think it both, because, I mean, it's a bit of a double-edged sword, because social media can actually really contribute to mental health, like badly to mental health and anxiety and bullying. So, but then it also gives people a platform to bring awareness around certain issues. So it works both ways. I can't imagine what it would be like to be a kid in high school with using social media and how tough that would be, because bullying's still so prevalent in high school, and I know that it's happening a lot more on social media too now. So
Yeah, it's that double-edged sword, isn't it? Yeah, the solution may exist somewhere in social media, but only if we treat it responsibly. And unfortunately, the first time we're introduced to social media is in those years where our brains are still forming, we're trying to find ourselves, and you use the words judgment. Judgmental, and the difference between judgment and being judgmental. That's the source of it. So your book, what's next? This one's out there. What's next?
So this is my fourth book of poems.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided after this one I was going to have a little bit of a break from writing poetry, just because it was a really big, hard experience writing. I got over 200 women that submitted their stories to me. Wow. So that was, and some of them were so painful, and so it was a really hard experience. So I just need a little break from poetry.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll keep writing, but I'm looking at a full-length novel next.
Okay, what's the subject matter of the novel?
That's all I can say.
Okay, right. Well, okay. Well, yeah. We'll stay tuned. We'll get you back on when the when that book's out. This has been absolutely fascinating. Four books and the latest one, Her Story. How do people get in touch? How do people get a copy?
Yeah, so you can get a signed copy on my website,
mm-hmm.
Which is Words by Jay Strelau. And if you look me up on Instagram, Jay Strelau, that's the best way to read the poems and check out if you like them, and then click on the link and go through to buy a copy. You can also get it on Amazon. It was their number one new release this week, so that's pretty cool. And you can get it at Scorpio Books in Christchurch and at the Next Chapter in Wanaka if you like to go into the bookshop, which I always like to do.
Tell me, how was it the first time you walked into a bookshop, or you went in and had the conversation with the bookshop owner and they said yes to stocking your book?
Yeah, it was really great. The first bookstore that ever stocked me was Scorpio Books,
mm-hmm.
and I go in there all the time to buy books. So, and they really support local poets. And mm-hmm. so does the Next Chapter, Wanaka, actually. And both of those bookstores are local bookstores, and I want to support local bookstores.
Mm-hmm.
And Scorpio Books has come back to me for multiple orders. So I do sell out there. So
fantastic.
Both ways. But, I do really appreciate the fact that they stocked me, because, like I said, I'm not a traditional poet.
Mm-hmm.
I am an Instagram poet, but there's a lot more of that kind of poetry around these days.
I think you're right. There is a new way of doing things. That traditional way that has always been isn't anymore. Self-publishing, I self-published Lead Through Life, and you're talking to, when I spoke to Ocean on the show last week, that whole transition from the traditional way of doing things is changing, and that means that there is so much more space for us creatives to actually get there without having to go to the big publishers.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's really great, because I mean, there's so many books that get self-published and become bestsellers, and then if they hadn't had the ability to do that, we never ever would have got to read those works. So yeah,
and everyone's story is someone else's start point. And the more stories we can get out there, the better. So we can get hold of your book if you are in Christchurch at Scorpio Books, or what's the name of the bookshop in Wanaka?
The Next Chapter.
The Next Chapter in Wanaka, or find you on Instagram and go to the link there. And obviously, if you can't do any of that, and you should be able to do the Instagram thing, if you can't do any of that, then go to Amazon, because, number one this week. That's absolutely fantastic. I have really, really enjoyed this conversation. Absolutely brilliant. And the fact that it landed on Pink Shirt Day and Gumboot Day, everyone.
I think it's Gumboot Day next Friday.
Oh, is it? Okay, well, wear them today anyway. Great. That's the title of next week's show then. I'll get my gumboots and best to polish them up a little bit. You chose a song. Tell me about why you chose Bruce Springsteen, I'm on Fire.
Well, the honest truth is that I'm very analytical, and I do work in media myself, and I just was like, well, I don't know what the audience for your show is, the demographic. So
I'm not entirely convinced I do either.
Well, I want a song that everybody liked, and I feel like that is a beautiful song and everyone likes it. But also, it is a poetic song. It makes you feel something. I think.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I chose it.
Brilliant. Okay, well, Julia, thank you so much for your time this morning. And here it is. I'm on fire.
Hey, little girl, is your daddy home? Did he go and leave you all alone? I got a bad desire. Oh, I'm on fire. Tell me now, baby, is he good to you? And can he do to you the things that I do? Oh, no. I can take you high. Like someone took a knife, baby, edgy and dull, and cut a six-inch valley through the middle of my skull. At night I wake up with the sheets soaking wet and a freight train running through the middle of my head. Only you can cool my desire. Oh, I'm on fire.
I'm on fire, Bruce Springsteen. What a great interview. I was just saying to Julia after the show, sometimes I wonder if we're going to get through 20 minutes of conversation, and not once have we dried up, because yeah, they're just such interesting subjects. And again, that whole concept of division, when we actually get talking, we're quite similar. We just need to realise that. We just need to realise that we are all on our own journeys, but if we walk side by side, it's always far more fun than walking alone. Which brings me nicely, you'd think I planned these things, which brings me nicely to today's book review. If you are watching Wairarapa TV, or if you're on the Arrow FM website, arrowfm.co.nz, The Resilient Show, today's book, The Places You Will Go by Dr. Seuss. Now, I know that Dr. Seuss got a bit of a bad rap in the press over the last few weeks, but The Places You Will Go, I hadn't heard of this one, and I grew up with Dr. Seuss, Green Eggs and Ham, and yeah, those books. I hadn't heard The Places You Will Go until my daughter was finishing up at junior school in Canada, where we lived at the time, and they did The Places You Will Go on stage. If you've not read it, you can find it on the interweb. Go and have a look on the interweb, The Places You Will Go, Dr. Seuss. It starts, congratulations, today is your day, you're off to great places, you're off and away. And then it tells the story. It tells the story that today is your day, your mountain is waiting, so get on your way. That's the beginning and end of The Places You Will Go. Go and read the in-between bits. Because a little bit like stepping out this morning and thinking that Scorpio was missing in the sky, it was only because I wasn't looking up. I wasn't looking out. I was looking too close to home. When I was interviewed on a podcast that's going out on Sunday with Jax Milan interviewed me for his podcast, and he asked me who I was, and I described me as, I'm just a wee boy from near Glasgow in Scotland, and you'll hear my accent beginning to come to the fore. And I saw the dying days of the shipyards on the Clyde. And those ships heading out of the Clyde estuary into the world. And I realised there was a whole world out there to explore. And that's what I've done. That's what I continue to do. I go out there and I explore the world about me. I explore the world within me an awful lot. But I explore the world out there. And I'm always looking for that next adventure. And the places you will go is just a great way of getting us thinking. I always find that Dr. Seuss gets me thinking, sometimes about weird stuff. But he gets me thinking. And if you start thinking about the places you'll go, where could you go? No, really, think about it right now. Where could you go? What could you do differently that creates a little bit more adventure in your life? Go out and create some more adventure. Go and talk to people that you wouldn't normally talk to. What a great way of getting rid of divides by actually breaking out of your tribe. So the places you will go, all the places you'll go by Dr. Seuss. It's not a long read. It's worth a look. It's a good fun read. If you pick up the book, there are some quite amusing, weird images in it. But the places you will go, have a look at it. And as Julia and I spoke about in the last interview, reflect on it. Reflect on the places you've been. Reflect on the places that you enjoyed. Reflect on the places that as a child you always dreamt of going. All the places you'll go. Because we can. We can step out. We can do everything we want. But I'm going to take you back. This next track takes me back to where it really all started for me. And much as I don't visit there very often, Caledonia is still on my mind.
I don't know if you can see changes that have come over me in these last few days. I've been afraid that I might drift away. So I've been telling old stories, singing songs that make me think about where I came from. That's the reasons why I seem so far away today. Let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me, and now I'm going home. For if I should become a stranger, you know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything I've ever had. Kept on moving, I proved the points that I needed proving. Lost the friends that I needed losing, found others on the way. Oh, and I have tried, I've kept on trying. I've stolen dreams, yes, there's no denying. I have traveled hard, with conscience flying somewhere with the wind. Think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me, now I'm going home. For if I should become a stranger, you know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything. Thank you. I'm sitting here before the fire, the empty room, the forest choir, the flames that couldn't get any higher. Well, they were withered, now they've gone. But I'm steady thinking, my way is clear, and I know what I will do tomorrow. When the hands are shaken and the kisses flowed, well, I will disappear. Oh, and let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me, now I'm going home. But if I should become a stranger,
actually just going to let that one play out. Caledonia, what a great track. I'm not about to leave New Zealand anytime soon, but I do often reflect on my visits to Scotland. I was brought up just outside Glasgow, as I said earlier, and you know, climbed and walked and visited all over Scotland, and it is a place that's still very close to my heart. And you know, that track just... Yeah, go back, listen to it again, listen on the playback of the show, and just reflect on your life, the places you've gone, the people you've left behind, the people who've stayed with you, and just reminisce a little bit, because it's sometimes in reminiscing that we see the pointers for the future. Now, I'm really, really excited. I don't think I've ever spoken to a sculptor before. Glenn Colchin, who lives in the Hawke's Bay, is a sculptor, and we're going to talk about all of his sculpting, or some of his sculpting, and the work he's got ongoing. But first of all, I want to ask him about what he was up to yesterday. Glenn, good morning. How is the Hawke's Bay this morning?
Good morning. Yeah, it's bright and shiny. It's that second day consecutive we've had lovely clean weather and no winds, because it was blustery a couple of days before that. But it's absolutely cracking.
And obviously no wind meant that your activity yesterday could happen. How was flying yesterday?
Yeah, no, it was perfect. Chris Hart, who took me up, he used to live behind me when I lived upon Church Road, which is down when I first came to New Zealand. And he was an air pilot for, Swiss Air, and then he went to Pacific Blue, I think it was, mm-hmm. on Singapore Airlines. And yeah, and so he did that for a while, but he's always been egging to say, you know, to take me out on in his plane, because he's got a little biplane for two people, two-seater. Mm-hmm. Took me out yesterday, yeah, and it was absolutely, yeah, it was just, it was like a mill pond, the sea, and the sky was just, there was hardly any clouds in it. It was just perfect condition for it.
Stunning. Yeah, so, where did you go? I don't know. Where did you go? What did you see?
We took off from Bridgepar, and then we flew out towards Napier. So we went over the top of our old house. We were showing me over the top of there, which mm-hmm. was in Taradale. And then we flew into Napier and went past the airport and then over the top of Hospital Hill and then down Marine Parade. Mm-hmm. And then I took over the controls and flew over top of Cape Kidnappers, where there's that exclusive golf course.
Yep.
I've never been up, and it's trolling for the rich list, I think, that can get up there. So I thought the only way I'm going to get over is by flying over. Mm-hmm. So we flew over that, and then we went down Ocean's Beach and then over towards Tomato Peak and flew over there. And Chris flung the airplane sideways so then I could wave at the people on the top of Tomato Peak. And then we flew back to Bridge Par, and that was it. That was the day. So it was 25 minutes, but yeah, we covered a lot of ground. Apparently it's a stunt plane, but he never pushed it the full hog. Because it had full fuel tanks, and he said that you can't actually going to do any stunts with a horse that's got
that just means you need to go back.
He has actually murmured that. He said that we could go back out again. I was like, yes, I will be there with you.
Fantastic. Yeah, I mean the time in the air. I'm a glider pilot. And learning to be a glider pilot, and that time once you get off the top of the winch, and that airborne time when there's plenty sky below you, and you can make up for your mistakes. It's absolutely glorious. That's not a Kiwi accent. Where are you from? How did you end up here?
My original place of birth is Wakefield in West Yorkshire.
Mm-hmm.
Home of Henry Moore and Barbara Hepworth, so they were two sculptors, big sculptors. So,
totally.
And Damien Hirst as well comes from Dewsbury, which is the next town along. So there's there's quite a thoroughbred of area for decent sort of sculptors and stuff. Not that I'm saying that I'm up there with them, but
maybe not yet. But I've seen some of your work. You're headed there.
Aim for.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. I was born there in 1975. My dad, he was heavily into hunting and fishing, and so we used to do a lot of hunting and fishing down in Yorkshire. And then on every holiday that we got, other people were going to Spain, but we were going straight up to Scotland because my dad absolutely loved it up there for hunting and fishing.
Mm-hmm.
So as soon as we got out of the car, I remember us back in a little, I think it was a Ford Maestro, a little van.
Yep.
And me, my brother, and my sister used to sleep in a sleeping bag in the back of the van. No, nothing to brace us down or anything. Sliding about in the back, going up the M1.
I remember doing the same, actually, from Glasgow to Aviemore. Yeah.
Yeah, and going all the way up there. And then, it was like early, we'd set off, like, ridiculous time, 3 o'clock in the morning or something ridiculous like that. So then when we got there, my dad could get straight out the car, mum look after us, and he goes hunting straight away off fishing. That was it. And we used to do that a lot. And then we actually ended up moving up to Scotland in 2006. And that was due to, because a lot of where we lived in West Yorkshire and Wakefield, especially, it was a mining community.
Mm-hmm.
I came from Criggleston, and a lot of that obviously all got shut down during Maggie Thatcher's reign. And so a lot of people were left destitute. And unfortunately, a lot of the families that it had been passed down from them to do mining, that was their only thing that they did in life. And so when that job went, there was nothing else really to do. So crime became an issue and alcohol and lots of other things. And it wasn't a nice place to live.
Mm-hmm.
So my dad and mum said, let's go. Let's move up to Scotland. We've got nothing to lose and let's get out of here. And we did that, and we moved up there, and luckily enough, we made a good life of it. And they still live in Scotland. My dad still gets up early in the morning and goes stalking. And even though he doesn't, like now, he's coming for 80, and he shoots the odd time, but he doesn't. It's too hard for him to pull the a stag or something like that on his own.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Whereabouts in Scotland?
Yeah, they're still loving it. They're in Sorby, which is Dumfries and Galloway.
Okay, so for people elsewhere, if you're looking at a map, the bottom left-hand corner.
Correct, yeah, southwest. Yeah. So that's the Gulf Stream apparently runs through that, and we get a bit of a tropical heat now and again, so I think that's probably the only place in Scotland that gets a lot of temperature. But because there's a tropical gardens there as well. Mm-hmm. I think it's Gatehouse of Fleet Tropical Gardens. Yes, yeah, it's a beautiful place. Absolutely, it's very reminiscent of New Zealand. You'll probably know that yourself with Scotland as well.
It just amazes me that we've ended up having this conversation. I mean, I didn't know that you spent time in Scotland or that your family lives in Scotland, and we've just played Caledonia. I mean, the way these things just happen just continually surprises me. You're right. I mean, Scotland and New Zealand. People often talk about how similar they are. Maybe just the scale's a little bit different. So what made you choose New Zealand?
It was funny. I'd obviously been in Scotland for a while and things. I wasn't very academic, and I was good. I was good at artworks. My daddy did watercolor painting as well. Mm-hmm. So what he did a lot of hunting scenes. Well, he still does hunting scenes, watercolor painting and things. And I decided, I wasn't really that infused in art, really. I enjoyed doing it, but I didn't see a way forward for me to have an actual job in it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went to college at Dumfries and Galloway and College of Technology, and in fact, I didn't have much of a brochure, a portfolio, so my dad actually stuffed a few of his paintings in there to show as well, and I pretended they were mine. And I actually got in. So I got in there, and this was at the, crikey, this will be like, probably, I'm trying to think, that'd be 91, probably somewhere around that. So Apple had just come out, I think, like an Apple computer for drawing. So I was, you know, starting to use that and other things, but I did that for 2 years, and I got my HMC, I think it was.
Yeah.
And then I decided to move back down to Yorkshire, and I thought, oh, I'll go back down and connect up back up with old friends and stuff, but it was a long time between, and obviously people move on and people change, and I never really met anybody again from my school down there, but I ended up still living down there, found a new pack of friends to go out with. And then ended up down there, but after a while, I've worked for a few different firms and things, and I got to, I used to go to a lot of music festivals, and I went to Leeds Music Festival. It was the first year it had actually been set up in Leeds, and I went along and I met my wife there, Janelle Frith, who's, she's a Kiwi and comes from Whanganui originally.
Right.
So she set up tent right next to my tent, and well, there's a bunch of them. They'd all come up from London, that was it. And so I met her at the, was it, I think it was Guns N' Roses and Prodigy were playing.
No, there's a mixture. Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So that was it was a wild weekend. It was great. And then that was it from there onwards. And so after about, we stayed there for together. In Wakefield, I bought a little house and stayed there for 9 years, and decided let's give it a go over in New Zealand, because it was 2009 and it was when the banks had all gone bust and things like that, there's a lot of disparity and things, and people weren't, you know, things weren't really very great, going on very well over in Britain, and I thought, well, let's go and do it. We've got nothing to lose. We're young enough. You know, we could sell up, and we'll try our way over in New Zealand. And
I think it's really, really interesting. You spoke about the loss of the mines in Yorkshire, as the aftermath that as your reason or your family's reason to move to Scotland, and then the banking crash as your reason to move to New Zealand. It's quite interesting how some people will just stay where they are and stagnate, but then there are others who have that wanderlust that decide, actually, we can go and try something different, somewhere different. It might just be the village next, or it might be the other side of the world.
Oh, totally. Sometimes it's just that you just need that. Sometimes you just need that catalyst. You know, it's always been there. You know, you've thought about it, but it's like you've come to the end of your tether and you think, right, I've got to make a change now, else it's not going to change at all, and you've just got to do it. And that seems to be a lot of points that's happened with me in my life. As we talk on, you'll see, it always seems to come to a crunch, and then I have to make a decision. And generally, it works out to be a good. Generally, it works out to be a good decision.
Okay, and there was the moment in this interview when I got the shivers. You're right. You're too often we look at those big challenges in life and decide not to do it because it's just too big a challenge. But actually, if we commit to it and we believe in it, oddly enough, it quite often works out, and sometimes it's better than you ever thought it would be. So how did you become a sculptor? How did you get into it?
I sort of just want to take on what you said as well.
Of course.
I actually went to my sister, well, my wife, when we first came over, she got a job with a real estaters, and we went to their awards ceremony, and they brought up I think he was a basketball coach, and he said something right at the end, which was really good, and it hit me. And he said, "Everybody's welcome to dream, you know, and we can all dream about different things, but sometimes you've got to wake up at some point and actually live that dream, you know, and and that's it. And a lot of people do that. They dream about it, but then they'll get right to the almost, you know, to the end of their lives and never actually done it. And it's, you've just got to make that, you've just got to do it. And you've got to, you know, sort of back yourself up and say, I'm doing it right. You know, it's all for the right cases. And you can feel it in your gut sometimes that it's the right thing as well.
Yeah, completely.
So, to dive in,
we will get to, guys, if you're listening in to listen to this interview about sculptors and sculpturing, and we will get there. I'm reading Tuesdays with Maury at the moment, which is an absolutely fantastic book about a chap who interviews an old man in his 80s about his thoughts on life as his life is ebbing away. And you're... Every time you talk to people of age, old people, the ones that have lived have truly lived. And quite often the ones that haven't, as they're realizing their end of time is coming in these earthly suits, they're wishing that they'd actually taken those gambles and wonder what if. And far rather to say, I tried, then look back and say, "Ah, oh, what if?" Anyway, let's get to sculpting. Wait, how did you start?
How I started. I when I was in Scotland, and I remember at school, there was one part of our art class, and we did some clay work and working with clay, and I went with it, and I thought, "Wow, this is amazing!" I'd never used it before, but I took to it really quickly, and being about 14 or 15, I remember I made a zombie.
Obviously, of course you did.
It was just a head, so it was the head and shoulders, and I did half the face, had the flesh on, and then the other half had the skull and stuff, and he's like screaming, and one eye socket's obviously not got an eyeball on it and things, and I fired it, and everybody was like blown away. They were like, "Wow, you've really got the scale and the form of the head, you know, really well and stuff," And I was really proud of myself. I was like, "Wow, you know, it's just one of those things again. It's just, you know, I'd never tried it. I thought I'll dive in, and it was a brilliant feeling that I'd, you know, done it." And I was like, "Wow, that just feels so brilliant with it." And so I fired it, which is when you put it in a kiln and you raise it to about 1,000 degrees, and then it turns to stone. And I gave it to my mum and dad. Mum and dad have still got it in their garden. It scares away the birds and stuff like that. and that was it really. That got me going, and then it kind of sat there and hibernated inside me for years and years. I never touched any more sculpture until I actually came to New Zealand in 2009. So that was probably about 87. So the seed had been planted, but then when we got to New Zealand, obviously you have a bit more time on your hands because you're not traveling as far for work and things. And decided to get myself a little hobby, and there was a local art group, clay group down the road at Waiheke Arts Village, and I thought, I'll join up. So I joined up, and first thing I said to him was like, "I've never worked with, I've worked with clay years ago, but I'd like to get into it again and have another go because I remember enjoying it." And I said, "Have you got any clay here?" And I said, "Well, we've got some on the wheels, because all the it's like, it's basically when they've been making pots or anything, all the rubbish clay falls off and it goes into a pot, and so you end up with a myriad of different types of clay."
Yeah.
And it's not the best to actually use that because all the different clay goes off at different temperatures. So if you put it in an oven, certain bits will go hard quicker than others, and it ends up cracking. So
right.
I said, "I'll tell you what, I'm going to do it anyway." So I did it, and I grabbed it all, and I mixed it and mixed it and mixed it. And then I made another head, and I did it in it was like 2 weeks or so. I'd done a full head and shoulders, and it was a Roman head, and he's it looked like a dignitary, and he's very characteristic face and everything, and he's looking off to the side, and I was absolutely, I was like blown away, and other people were blown away how quickly I'd done it, because there was a few other people that have been there for quite a few years, and they've been training and stuff, and it was like, they were saying, "It must have taken you like months to do that." And I was like, "No, it didn't." And
great.
It obviously came natural. And I was like, "Well, that's great." But they said, "Look, it's not going to live. You know, when you put it in the firing, because you've used all that clay, it's not going to live." And I was like, "Oh, put it in anyway." So we put it in the it's an outdoor fire. It was a massive wood kiln.
Mm-hmm.
We put it in there, and it was the kiln was on for 3 days, so we had to all put wood in and keep it going. And it came out perfect. Everybody was to everybody's disgust. And I think they were like, "What? I can't believe that." And in fact, it put apples. We'd use a lot of apple trees when we put it in, and it wasn't just that. The colour, it flicked a colour of green up the front of it, which was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
The patina, like a patina colour, it came out absolutely amazing. So, yeah, and I've still got him in the garden. So he's my little trophy. And that was it from there onwards. And I just kind of snowballed on from doing that.
I think you're yet again, and I'm really seeing a theme here. Yet again, someone tells you, yeah, that's not going to work. That's going to fall a bit. And it's just, I'll just do it anyway. And it works. There's a lesson for life. Just do it anyway. It's if it doesn't work, it's a lesson. But you've moved on from clay now to other materials.
Correct. Yeah, I'd gone from clay, and then I was because I was working as an engineer at that point. I got a job at a place in Napier, and I was working on the shop floor using copper because I was in refrigeration and things. Mm-hmm. And not that I got qualifications in it, but they took me on with the hindsight that I'd be able to pick it up. And so I did that, used copper, and I was learning brazing. So I got all that under my belt. And then, and it kind of came from there. Sort of, I thought, well, clay's not really paying the bill. You know, it's not going to pay the bills as such. Mm-hmm. It's really hard, and there's a lot of risk involved in clay because it takes a long time to dry out. It goes in the kiln, it could crack. The glaze might not go right. There's a lot of different things. So I thought, well, I'm not going to be able to make a job out of that if I did go that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I jumped out of that, and I thought, I'll go on to wood. Even though I'd done this brazing, I thought, I'll have to go with wood, because once you've dealt with wood and carved it, you don't have to put in a kiln, and you can put it straight on the shelf and sell it. So mm-hmm. I did a couple of pieces of that, and that did okay. But I just thought, well, metal, it's just something that lasts forever, and people pay more money for it. It seems to have more value
mm-hmm.
in it. And so I thought, right, okay, then I'm going to have a go with copper. I'm going to work with copper with wood. So mm-hmm. I mixed the two, and oak and copper seem to work, they marry so well.
Right.
And so what I did, I made a set of brown trout. Mm-hmm. So I used heart remu for the bodies, carved all that out. And then I used copper for the fins. And then for the spots on the side, I actually drilled holes and then inlaid copper, mm-hmm. copper spots.
Yep.
And then I made a reed of copper, which was like, so it's floating reed of copper, and it was attached to a piece of Franz Josef stone. So mm-hmm. this reed of copper sits up high, but it flows with the water, if you can imagine, all the tendrils off. And then and then the fish were sitting right there suspended around that piece of reed mm-hmm. all the way up. So there's three of them either side, and that was it then. I got there, you know, I was like, wow, I really enjoy this. I'm really into it.
And I can hear that. You can hear the passion. You've just painted a perfect picture of that piece of art.
Yeah. The thing is, because like natural life for me, I mean, a lot of people do, you know, they'll do abstract paintings and things like that, but there's nothing better than natural for me. Like, because I lived obviously in going hunting and fishing and things like that. You just see it every day. It's all around you. We just take it for granted. I mean, look at a leaf and just the colours it goes into during autumn and the shapes that come from it, and, you know, and the trees, the way that they've grown, and they've got so much character in the way they bend and things like that, and you can read a story from them. It's the same with animals, and if you can get animals, for me, it's getting the life into them. If I can get the movement, mm-hmm. then it's just made it. You just need a few subtle movements within it, and it's just alive, and that's what I try and go for each time, just to show that living being in there.
One of your latest pieces that I've seen a couple of images of, and actually quite personal to me, the oak tree with the acorn. What's the reason for that piece of work, and where's that going to end up?
Yeah, that one, well, this year's been really good. This is another thing, like, I'll say, if we've got enough time. But
yeah,
what happened last year, I was made redundant from, because when I was working in engineering, I'd asked on the last 2 years, so I was there for about 9 years, if I could go to 4 days.
Yeah.
Because my artwork was starting to do really well, so I wanted to spend a bit more time on that. But the unfortunate thing for me is I always love a challenge, and I ended up learning a lot of other people's roles within my office. Mm-hmm. So I became quite valuable, so they wouldn't let me take any time off because I could cover other people's jobs.
There's probably a lesson there somewhere.
Yeah, definitely, mate. And I, so what I did, I said to myself, I'm going to have to leave and go somewhere else. I bit the bullet and I went and jumped into doing kitchen design, which I'd never done before.
Yeah, as you do, of course.
But as you do. But the thing was, I'd learnt SolidWorks 3D, so I could actually, I could model things. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, I've got a design stint, so the two things should marry into it, and I can work with wood. So, and I did a lot of design work. So I jumped into there, started in January last year, and then I was made redundant during COVID, unfortunately, because I was the last in, first out.
Mm-hmm.
so it was like, wow, well, what do I do now? So I thought, I want to do my artwork, so it's probably the best time now, because I'm locked at home. I've got my little 4-year-old at that time. My wife worked for the hospital, so I was looking after my little girl. So I thought, right, start doing artwork. So I started posting online, and luckily enough, there was a new site opened up on Facebook called, I think it was called Made in New Zealand then, and it went off, it went crazy. So it was all crafts and artwork from New Zealand.
Yep.
And I think they got around about 250,000 people join that group within a few weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And then I decided, I'll put my work up that I've made over the past year and things, posted it, and I must have got around about 4,000, 5,000 people had liked it, and then started commenting and wanting to order, different things and commissions.
Wow, so the order book's full.
Yeah, so what happened was I got an order book of about, I got about $4,000 worth of orders. So I was like, okay, well, this is it. I'm going for it. So I started rolling with it. It just carried on. And I kept going. And then I went and got, I thought, right, well, if I'm going to push it even further, I'll see if I can get myself a mentor.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd done an exhibition at King's College up in Auckland the year before. I'd made a large sculpture of a stag. And
that was amazing. That's an absolutely beautiful
thank
piece.
You, yeah. And it sold on the doors opening. Like, it was, what, I would say 6 minutes and it sold. I couldn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually went to Graham Hart's daughter, Gretchen Hawksby. And then somebody else asked for one as well. So I sold two on that day. And at that show, a guy was there called James Wright, who's a sculptor up in Auckland.
Mm-hmm.
He was on a show called Design Junkies about 2 seasons ago.
Right.
And I got on with him really well. He's real down to earth. He's been working in sculpture for years. And I said, would you be my mentor? And he said, of course I will. I was like, yay. So he took me on, and then that was it. And it's just like I bolstered myself up, and I tried to sort of, what would you say, galvanize myself in a way, get as many people around me and get as much information. And it just seemed to take off from then. So this year I've got 3 awards I've been accepted for an award in Wellington called the Richard T. Nelson Awards, which is in June. It's a Queen's birthday weekend, and I have to make 2 small sculptures for it.
Right.
To be 1 square meter in size. So one of them is the oak, is from From Tiny Acorns to Mighty Oaks Grow, which is the one I'm making now.
It's amazing.
And then the second I'm making out of river stone and wire, and it's going to be a bull. So I'll be making that out of those two
fantastic
mediums as well.
So how do I'm really, really enjoying this, and I've just looked at the time. How do people find your art? Where can they go to have a look at your artwork?
Yeah, they can go on Facebook, they can go on there and go on GC Sculptor.
Mm-hmm.
So that's G for Glenn, C for Culture and Sculptor, and that's C S C ULPTOR. And then I've got a website called, glencultgin.com, is it? Just give me a second. I'll go get my business card. It's right here. It's www.gcolchin, so that's colechin.com. And I also have an Instagram, which is at GC Sculptor as well. And I'm on LinkedIn, so I'm everywhere.
Cool. So do go and have a look at Glenn's work, because it is absolutely amazing. I find that I can disappear into the pieces of art. They are absolutely beautiful. Go and take look. You chose a track. Tell me about why you chose The Night by Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons.
Yeah, that track there is... It's funny because I wasn't into the Northern Soul as such when I was in Yorkshire, but when I came away from there, I kind of hankered back to the Northern Soul music, and that was such a big tune for the Northern Soul group. And so Northern Soul was set back in the 60s. A lot of the soul music and stuff got into Britain, and Rolling Stones and other bands jumped onto that bandwagon.
Yeah,
and it kind of passed on through right up into the north. But we actually kept it going up in Yorkshire and around that area. And London actually moved on to different other musics and trends, but we actually kept it going. And it's still a massive big scene. And yeah, Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons, The Night, was one of the big tunes for the Northern Soul side.
All right, brilliant. So, Glenn, thank you very much for your time. Here is your track. Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons and The Night. What an amazing interview. I could have kept talking to Glenn for like ever. Such an interest and a story of tenacity, a story of just believing in yourself, backing yourself to win and going out there and doing it. Absolutely amazing. And as ever, both interviews ran over, so now we're squeezed at the end. So I have got one hack. Today is Pink Shirt Day in New Zealand. Go out there, find your pink shirt, and if you can't, raid your wife's wardrobe, grab a pink scarf or something. I'm actually feeling quite warm. It's lovely. I'm going to wear it all day today. Think about bullying. Don't just wear the pink shirt today. Don't just give verbiage to the fact that it's Pink Shirt Day today. This is a way that we should be living our lives every day, not just once a year. We should recognise that the bullies are out there. We should feel sorry for them, because actually it's inadequacy in them that's causing them to be bullies. But when we start questioning ourselves, we have to look deep inside and realise that sometimes we bully ourselves too, and we've got to stop doing that. And one simple way that I use to recognise if I'm maybe heading in that direction, not just towards myself, but towards other people, is to ask myself the question, I wonder why. Bullying and being unkind is being judgmental. It's believing that we're right and everyone else is wrong. If we ask ourselves the question, I wonder why, then we flip from being judgmental to using our judgment. And if we use our judgment by asking the question, I wonder why, then actually we begin to close the divide. We begin to realise that we're not that different. Human beings are herd animals. We need our tribes. We need to join our tribes together. So ask the question, I wonder why. Become less judgmental and use more judgment. So tonight, or today, we're going to finish the show with that track that Ocean thought he'd chosen. Ocean Reeve of Ocean Reeve Publishing, who we interviewed last week. Great interview. Go back, go to the website. You can re-listen to that interview. But he thought he'd asked for Humble and Kind. And if there's a lesson for anything regarding bullying and this day, Pink Shirt Day in New Zealand, it is that we should all be a little bit more humble and kind.
You know there's a light that glows by the front door. Don't forget the keys under the mat. When childhood stars shine, always stay humble and kind. Go to church 'cause your mama says to. Visit grandpa every chance that you can. It won't be wasted time. Always stay humble and kind. Between sleeping with someone and sleeping with someone you love. I love you, ain't no pickup line, so always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't cheat, and don't lie. I know you got me.
Think of a much better way to end today's show. Humble and kind. Pink Shirt Day in New Zealand. Let's bring an end to bullying by actually thinking, asking the question, I wonder why. Because in that way, we can all use our judgment far better and we can bring more and more humility and kindness into the world. This was the Resilient Show. Two great interviews and some absolutely awesome music. I will see you next week for another show. Have a great day. Be humble and be kind.